Freddy vs. Ash, a fan novel by A.S. Eggleston. Chapter 1. Ash found himself in the heart of the desolate woods. He didn't know exactly where he was. He didn't know how he even got there. Then again, considering all the head injuries he had sustained over the years, it was a wonder he could remember his name. This was just like any other night for Ash. Come home from work, hear from the locals about some poor sap going missing, and find himself in a place like this, to make sure the deadite plague doesn't spread any further. This has been his life for the past 30 years. It's a noble job, and everything to protect the innocent and all, Ash would often say to himself, but I wonder sometimes what life would have been like for me if I'd never gone to that blasted cabin. Linda and I were serious. Who knows? Maybe we would have gotten married, had a few kids, and lived happily ever after. But any prospects of that were dead and gone, literally. Nowadays, Ash doesn't really have time for an exciting love life. Even if he did, he couldn't risk it. It seemed like everyone he ever cared about, everyone he was close to, died around him. He didn't want to risk getting his heart broken again. Again, very flattering to be the guy to rid the world of deadites, but it still sucked. As he walked through the woods, Ash noticed something about his surroundings, something about where he was. It just didn't seem normal. Of course, being miles away from town, looking for some possessed monster to hack off with a chainsaw, wasn't very normal in the first place, but seemed like something was off. Ash looked up at the moon. It was full and glowing red. That was never good. A thick cover of fog surrounded him as he walked deeper into the woods. Even if the guy was here, Ash wouldn't be able to see him unless he was extremely close. And the trees just looked as if they were staring right at him, as if they were monitoring and surveying him. The long, leafy branches looked like they were ready to completely engulf him. He slowly and cautiously walked past the thick tree trunks. He glided his hand against the bark, getting a feel for where he was going. He felt blinded by the dense fog around him. While the glow of the moon provided a somewhat ethereal ambiance, it did nothing in terms of leading his path. As he walked past the trees, he heard a sound, like someone was walking beside him. He whipped his head to the side, waving the fog from in front of him. He didn't see anyone, and continued walking. But in the back of his mind, Ash could have sworn he saw something with red and green stripes hiding behind the tree a few yards away from him. Ash had been walking for quite some time now, ever since sundown it felt like. He was exhausted. Carrying a chainsaw on your right hand and a double-barreled shotgun on your left was harder than it looked. Ash was tired of these games. They always hid in the corner, waiting to sneak up on him. Ash wanted them to just show up so they could die already. He put his shotgun back in his holster and leaned back against the tree trunk behind him. He took just a few moments to relax, rest, and try to figure out where this demon could possibly be. Ash was breathing pretty heavily. Hunting down deadites and sawing their limbs off was harder than it used to be. He wiped the sweat off his brow and mumbled, "Damn it, where are you?" Before he could finish, he felt a pair of cold, grimy hands around his throat. They squeezed tighter and tighter, muffling Ash's screams. The hands belonged to a set of large and muscular arms, pushing Ash flat on the ground. It was him. The undead bastard waited for the perfect opportunity to rip through the fog and attack Ash as soon as he let his guard down. But the ugly, decayed giant didn't account for one thing. Ash was the one with the chainsaw. As the demon chanted, "Join us! Join us!" Ash wasted no time reaching over and starting up his favorite weapon. He couldn't afford to goof around, as he was losing air fast. That's right, he didn't need to reload a chainsaw. He pulled the recoil as hard as he could. Nothing. He pulled it once more. Nothing again. He did, however, need to refuel a chainsaw. "Well, this is just great." Ash was slowly losing consciousness. He was being choked out by some rotted demon who weighed about 2 tons. He tried one last time. "Come on," he said. His voice was scratchy. Finally, Ash grinned from ear to ear. He directed his attention to the living undead hovering over him. "Hey, buddy," he said. "Your insides could use some arranging." He rammed his chainsaw right into the guy's stomach and through his spine, shredding his guts away. The living corpse shook and convulsed as the chainsaw cut through his stomach and chest. Blood sprayed in every direction, causing Ash's face and body to be covered in thick, gooey redness. Who's laughing now, huh? Ha 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 ha! Once the monster was completely disemboweled, Ash threw him off and got back on his feet. He studied him for a second, already smelling the rotting guts that were now exposed to the air. He looked at all of the blood and intestines that spilled over the creature. Ash would be lying if he said he didn't take a little pride in his work. He pulled out his shotgun and aimed it at the guy's head. If there's one thing he knew about deadites, it's that they always like to come back for one last scare. The creature's eyes were blank white, looking and nothing and everything at the same time. He was still for a minute. He jerked his head up and reached for Ash, when his entire head suddenly exploded from the impact of the shotgun blast. He was finally dead. Gray smoke rose from the barrel. Ash nonchalantly blew it away, spun the gun once with his thumb, and placed it back in the holster. Ash turned and walked away. Now he could return back home and grab a cold beer that had his name on it. Snap. What was that? Ash looked around. There was no one there. Must have been a squirrel or something. He carried on and continued walking, wiping the blood off his face. He didn't want to drive back to town covered in blood and carrying an arsenal of weapons. Probably best not to cause any suspicion. Snap, snap. Just keep walking. Ash couldn't let his paranoia control him. Besides, he was almost to his car, a 1973 Delta 88 Oldsmobile, the classic, as he liked to call it. Even though it had been wrecked a few dozen times, it still managed to take him where he needed to go. He opened up the trunk and unlocked his chainsaw from his arm and set it inside. He slammed the trunk closed and headed for the door. Almost there. Join us! He whipped around and saw bodies coming from everywhere, rising from the dirt, emerging from within the woods. They were even up high, hiding in the branches of the trees. They were disgusting and decrepit. Their faces were locked in permanent, demented smiles. Ash quickly reached for his shotgun and opened up the barrel to reload. He grabbed two shells from his shirt pocket. Several hands rose from the dirt, grabbing Ash by the ankles and knocking him down. They all surrounded him in a circle, hovering over him, and reached down to scratch his flesh. He could hear their demonic chant, "Join us! Join us!" This had never happened before. Ash was completely powerless. There were too many of them. He did all he could. He tried to break away, but they kept pulling him back. He saw that his shotgun had landed next to him. He managed to grab it, replace the shells, and cock it in a matter of seconds. One down. He then aimed for one that was about to reach over to his leg and take a bite of his flesh. Another one down. But they still swarmed, and he was out of bullets. All he could do was just punch and kick the living hell out of them. "Get off of me!" he yelled. They just kept coming for him, holding him down so he couldn't move. "When will you stop torturing me like this?" he howled. Suddenly, mere inches from his face, was another disfigured creature. It was small, female, with little blonde pigtails. This horrible monster used to be a sweet little girl. Her face showed nothing but evil and a lust for blood. She spoke to him, replying to his cries of terror. "We will not stop until you set him free." She opened her mouth wide, revealing a set of sharp fangs for teeth. Black blood came pouring out of her mouth. She stuck out her tongue. It was long, green, and absolutely disgusting. She laughed. Her voice quickly changed from that of a little girl to something low, guttural, and evil. Her face and body morphed. Her skin was no longer pale and smooth. It appeared to be burned with scars everywhere and fleshy sinews hanging from her face. She no longer looked like herself. It was now someone completely different. It was a man. The same man wearing the red and green stripes on his shirt from before. Ash shouted at the disfigured man, "Ah, who the hell are you?" He quickly lunged towards Ash, wearing what looked like knives on his fingers. Ash screamed at the top of his lungs. He feared for his life. No! No! The four blades were now inches from his eyes. Ah! Ash screamed until he gasped for breath. He found himself sitting up, back in his own bed. It was all just a dream. I'm fine now, he said, reassuring himself. It was just a bad dream. He felt a sharp pain run across his right arm. He looked at it. There were scratch marks on it. Some of them had blood seeping from the wounds. He was now unsure of himself. Or maybe it wasn't. Ever since he came to Springwood, things just got even stranger. He figured, I'll get out of Michigan for a while, rent a house for cheap, rid this town of its deadites, do my heroic duty, move on somewhere else, like I always do. But something wasn't right about this house. He couldn't believe he got something this nice for so cheap. Two stories, three bedrooms, huge kitchen. It even had a basement to keep all of his gear in. Of course, he assumed something bad had to have happened at 1428 Elm Street. But it's not like Ash wasn't equipped to handle a haunted house. But still, something about this place just gave him a bad feeling. Ash laid back down, but he certainly didn't go back to sleep. Chapter 2. Ash never even so much as rested his eyes for the rest of the night. It was completely illogical to stay awake for an entire night just because some bad dreams, and he knew it, but they felt real to him. He could feel that huge, bulking deadite's blood gushing all over his body. He could feel the claws scratching and breaking his skin open. He could even smell the foul stench of that guy's rotting intestines exposed to the night air. Ash still couldn't explain to himself how those scratch marks appeared on his arms. Maybe I did that in my sleep, he thought. It didn't make sense, but that was the only reasonable answer he could come up with. He muttered to himself, these damn nightmares are killing me. He sat in the middle of the couch in the living room, slumped over and completely ragged. For the rest of the night, he kept himself busy by flipping through various infomercials on TV and drinking his coffee straight from the pot. Who needs a mug? He said, justifying himself. It was apparent to Ash that he was going to need a lot of this stuff, and a tiny little mug that reminded him how much he hates Mondays wasn't going to cut it. He took a small drink, grimaced, and spit it back out. Coffee that's bitter and tastes like dirt isn't going to cut it either. Ash grabbed a handful of sugar packets and ripped them open, pouring them in the pot. Yeah, how about a little sugar, baby? He muttered to himself, shaking the packets to make sure every last grain went into the coffee. His hair was a mess. It was ragged and hadn't been washed in days. He'd accumulated puffy bags under his eyes. Ash was exhausted, dazed, and had caffeine running through his system. It didn't sit well. The hazy look in his eyes and his hand twitching as he lifted the coffee pot to his face showed it. Morning had finally come, and if Ash hadn't already chugged an entire pot of coffee by now, this was usually the time of day when he'd start his first cup. When he drank it down to the last drop, he slammed the pot down and turned off the television. The sunlight broke through the curtains in the living room. The lights illuminated on the wall clock just across the room, 7:23 a.m. It was time for Ash to detach himself from the couch cushions and get ready for work. Before he got up, he quickly decided to take one last packet of sugar, tear it open, and hope those 4 grams would give him enough of a sugar high to get through the day. He tossed the empty packet on top of the pile already scattered across the coffee table. He took a much-needed shower and put on fresh clothes. Ash went into the bedroom, quickly picked up a comb, and ran it across his head a few times. Before he left, he grabbed his name tag that read Ashley J. Williams, Housewares Department, and pinned onto his shirt. He shuffled his feet back downstairs, grabbed his black leather jacket from the coat hanger by the front door, and he was off. He stepped outside and squinted at the sight of the morning sun. He shielded his eyes with his metal hand and walked over to his Delta 88. He opened up the trunk. It was a mess. There were empty liters of soda, a couple issues of Fangoria, boxes of shotgun shells, and a chemistry textbook inside. Not much has changed, except now Ash had stuck a note on the top of the trunk. It read, the words, Klaatu, Verada, Nictu, scribbled in pencil. There were some eraser marks on Nictu, indicating he wrote down a few other words and realized that they didn't belong. He always had some trouble remembering that one. He took the note and put it in his front pocket. I'm gonna find that damn book, and when I do, I'm gonna make sure you guys never come after me again. He promised to himself. He promptly slammed the trunk.
Shop smart, shop S-Mart.
Hail to the king, baby.
He came into work about half an hour early, which didn't bother him in the slightest. Anything to stay awake, right? He strode through the pneumatic doors of the Springwood S-Mart and took off his jacket. He paced his way to the housewares department, casually waving at the other clerks he passed by. Ash was lucky he had found an S-Mart in this town. His first job was a stock boy in Dearborn, Michigan, back when he was in high school. It was pretty much the only thing he knew how to do that was marketable. Of course, Ash didn't plan on staying here for very long. He'd heard this town had a bad history. There were a lot of murders, mostly children, but no one would go into detail beyond that. Maybe that had something to do with my dream. The little girl. Maybe this town has a bunch of dead-eyed kids running around. Eh, I've been through worse. Among the clerks Ash passed by were two kids that worked the checkout counter. Their names were Evelyn Marshall and Cooper Reynolds, two 18-year-olds who had their whole lives ahead of them. They were a couple, and seeing them together made Ash sick to his stomach. There they were, these happy kids without any cares beyond whether or not they'll be able to pay their rent payment. Meanwhile, Ash is condemned to a life of demon slaying. But he didn't mind catching a glimpse of Evelyn now and then. She was a pretty girl. She had big, beautiful green eyes that would stop anyone dead in their tracks when she looked at them, and had jet black hair that stopped at her waist. She leaned over at the checkout counter, looking very bored. The store wasn't going to open for another 30 minutes. She saw Ash waving at her as he walked by, so she smiled at him and waved back. Cooper was standing next to her. He noticed the exchange between them. He leaned over towards her. You know he's got to be twice your age, right? He said with a smirk on his face. Evelyn stood up and playfully punched him in the arm. Cooper raised his hands in defeat and stood up straight. He was really tall and lanky. He was 6'3", so when he stood up, he towered over Evelyn. Hey, I'm just saying, he said with a laugh. I didn't know you had a thing for the Elvis impersonator type. I was only being nice, she said. Besides, I don't. I have a thing for you. She wrapped her arms around his waist. He put his arms around her waist as well. Yeah, I know. I was just teasing you, he said with a loving smile. Hey, Evelyn, he asked, his smile getting wider. Guess what? She matched his smile. What? He leaned in and whispered, chicken butt. Evelyn snickered and smacked the side of his arm. That's not funny anymore. She ran her fingers through his shaggy, dark blonde hair before walking away laughing. Cooper put on a dramatic face and pointed at her. You lie, he shouted. The clock read 9:05 a.m. in the office of Lieutenant Harold Moore at the Springwood Police Department. Moore was a striking individual, 6'4", broad shoulders, blonde hair, and a beard on his square jaw. Moore was in his 60s and had joined the police academy a few years after Fred Krueger's arrest back in 68. He had never heard of a man so sick and vile. The things that he did to those innocent children made Moore sick just from the thought of it. Before Moore had joined the force, his predecessor, Lieutenant Donald Thompson, did everything he could to make sure Krueger was put behind bars. But they made the mistake of searching his home without a warrant. There was nothing they could do, so they rounded up the parents of Elm Street to torch the bastard. Moore watched from afar as the parents gathered to take justice into their own hands. He hated the concept of murder. That's why he despised Krueger and what he did to those little boys and girls. But when that Molotov cocktail burst through the glass window and sent the whole building on fire, he felt a wash of relief over him. Relief that Krueger was dead, and the children of Elm Street were safe in their own beds. That is, until the killing started again in 81. More, the entire police department, nor the parents, knew how, but Fred Krueger started killing again, this time in their children's nightmares. Children started to die by Krueger's blades in their sleep. Children were murdered by him more than they ever did when he was alive. They didn't know how to stop it. It was only until Lieutenant Thompson's daughter, Nancy, an intern at Weston Hills Psychiatric Hospital, had prescribed the children hypnosil. It was a dream suppressant. It was perfect. It was a way to stop the dreaming. Several years ago, the entire town had concocted a plan to keep Freddy away from their children. Anyone who had even made mention of a man with burnt skin and razor fingers in their dreams was hauled off to Weston Hills with no access to the outside world. It worked for a while. Eventually, the town's plan had been interfered when another killer had entered their once peaceful town. Luckily, Jason Voorhees had been driven out of Springwood before the whole town could be infected with fear. It was always the fear that drove Freddy. By now, the town's plan had been altered to a lesser degree. Anyone 18 or younger would be given hypnosil, under the guise of pain medication or everyday vitamins. Moore felt that this was a more humane way to keep the problem under control, rather than forcibly admitting them to a psychiatric hospital. It worked for several years. There was no more nightmarish activity in the town for 10 years after the plan had taken effect. But recently, a few weeks ago to be exact, a few unexplained murders had taken place just outside of town. He was befuddled by the occurrences. Even more so, he was worried. Moore was sorting through murder records when Officer Nathan Harris opened the door to his office. He was in his early 30s with a semi-strong build. He had spiky black hair with thin glasses settling on the bridge of his nose. He had only been on the force for a few years and was still learning the ropes. But after living in Springwood for most of his adult life, he became acquainted with the town's history. He poked his head out of the door and knocked on the wall. "Lieutenant," he asked, "is this a bad time?" Moore's gaze peeled away from the papers and looked up at Harris, who stood at the far side of the room. He replied, "No, Harris. It's all right." He waved his fingers, instructing him to come in. "But make it short. What is it now?" Nathan walked in, carrying a folder in his hand. Moore assumed it was more crime scene photos. "I'm just very confused about what's been going on around here lately, sir." "I assume you mean the murders?" he said bluntly. "Yes, sir," answered Harris. Harold leaned back in his chair and tried to rub the gruesome visions of the crime scene photos from his eyes. He had seen enough for one day. "What exactly is there to be confused about?" he asked, almost remorsefully. "For a long time, the distribution of hypnosil to every home in the town worked. But you know as well as I do, in this town, these plans only work for so long." "No, no," rebutted Nathan. "It's not that. At least, I don't think it is." He laid the folder down in Moore's desk and showed him the pictures and reports. "Take a look at these records, sir. This isn't like the usual murders done by Krueger. I don't think he's even involved in these."
"Why do you say that?"
"Well, just compare the two," he said. "Usually the murders done by Krueger are in places where there are children, schools, homes, yada yada, and the victims, 9 times out of 10, are kids, teens." He spread the pictures all over his desk. "But in these, most of the victims are 25 or older and occur in the outskirts of town. Most of the bodies we find are in the woods, sir." He looked at the pictures.
"You may have a point there, Nathan," he said, "but these murders look very brutal. How can you be sure it wasn't him? Maybe he changed his methods."
"Look at the pattern here." He pointed to the picture, showing a man who had his limbs sawed off and his head shot. "Whenever Freddy killed someone, he always left 4 continuous slash marks all over their bodies. In this one, this man's arms and legs had been cut off with some sort of saw, and we found traces of shotgun shells in his skull. This man was murdered, but not by Freddy."
"So what? We got another maniac on the loose?" he concluded.
"Great." He put the papers back in the folder. "But that's not it, sir. It's very strange, and I can't really explain it."
"What is it?" asked Moore.
Harris searched for the right words, but it was just so odd that it felt weird even talking about it. "It's just that..." He closed the folder and leaned down, putting his hands on the desk. "I talked to the medical examiner today, and she said that the bodies were already decomposing hours before their pronounced time of death. And their blood? She said that
they had different colors of blood in their bodies. Red, green, black. In their eyes, they had no pupils. They were just white. Doesn't that strike you as kind of, well, creepy, sir? Harold leered at him, disgusted by the visual images that came with what Harris had just told him. My God, that is disgusting, he said. Are you absolutely sure about that? Positive, confirmed Nathan. And I've done some research, and there were bodies like this found in other towns all across the country. What do you think we should do about this, or is there anything we can do? Moore put his elbows on his desk and rubbed his temples in an attempt to subside his headache. I don't know what we can do about these people just yet, he said, but we do know that each of them were murdered, and I can tell from the use of a shotgun and whatever type of saw that it's being done by the same guy. So first things first, I want you to track down our murderer, then we'll find out whatever the hell was going on with these people at the time. Okay, Harris nodded as he secured the folders in his hand and walked away. I'll get right on it. He quietly shut the door behind him as he left.
Shop smart, shop S-Mart.
Hail to the king, baby.
By noon, everyone had gone to lunch. Ash had traded his coffee for a 20-ounce energy drink. He knocked it back like he was drinking tequila out of a shot glass. His routine seemed to work. He didn't feel any compulsion to go to sleep at all. Not at all. In the garden apartment, Cooper and Evelyn were both lying in a hammock that was on display swinging side to side. He looked into her eyes. You're beautiful, he said. Evelyn smiled, revealing her pearly white teeth. You're handsome, she replied. Cooper leaned in closer to her face. Not as handsome as you. Evelyn laughed. Her gaze trailed off and noticed Ash from across the way. Cooper noticed her looking at him. So what's this Ash guy all about? He inquired. Where's he from? I don't know, Evelyn added. I heard he got transferred from the store in Dearborn. Where's that at? He asked. It's in Michigan. Cooper watched as Ash crushed a can with his metal, semi-robotic hand and threw it in the trash. He seems like a fucking psychopath to me. Evelyn smiled a little bit. Well, he is from Michigan. Hey, he protested. I'm from Michigan. My point exactly, she said with a smile. They laughed quietly, hoping Ash wouldn't hear them. Cooper noticed Ash walking away, not towards them, but he was getting close. As he walked past, Ash looked over at Evelyn, cocked his eyebrows, and gave her a sly smile. Evelyn shrugged it off, but Cooper wasn't going to let it go that easily. What Evelyn saw as a cheesy but innocent flirtation, Cooper translated as, I want to bang your girlfriend. Cooper simply watched him the entire time he walked, burning a hole in the back of his head with his eyes.
Okay, Slashaholics, this has been chapters 1 and 2 of Freddy vs. Ash, the fan novel by A.S. Eggleston. I'm enjoying it so far. I'm really curious to see more of the Freddy and Ash scenes. I thought it was pretty cool kicking off the first chapter with Ash having a nightmare, a Freddy-induced one, where he's fighting deadites and everything, so that was pretty cool. I'm digging the fact that we're going to just have a one-on-one here, you know, no Jason thrown into the mix. Although, I would love to see a Freddy versus, an Ash versus Jason novel as well. That could be fun, since Jason is a deadite, according to Jason Goes to Hell, which is one of my favorite Jason movies. Unpopular opinion, I know. Let me know what you guys thought of chapters 1 and 2. I did like some of the characters we met, original characters, and mentions and nods to past movies in the Nightmare on Elm Street franchise and the Evil Dead franchise. It's kind of funny that Ash is found an S-Mart that just happened to be in Springwood. Okay, that's cool. It's got to be a little tongue-in-cheek, so that's okay. But it looks like he's about to be investigated, may become a suspect in a serial killer case in town. I'm curious to see how that's going to pan out. And if this little Evelyn's boyfriend
that the S-Mart's going to cause any trouble for Ash because of his jealousy. So I'm curious to see what you guys think. Hit me up in the comments section, let me know. Also, if you can guess correctly what the picture on the screen right now is, even though it's really hard to see, it's all blurry and everything, if you can tell me who it is and from what movie, and you're the first person to get it right in the comments, you're going to win some horror ebooks, like Halloween 1 and 2, Child's Play 2 and 3, stuff like that, that I'll email to the winner. I'm going to do this for every narration. It's going to be a lot of fun. Have fun trying to guess it. It's going to be very hard. I'm curious to see how many people get it right. So it's on the screen right now as I'm talking, and I'll see you soon. With more Freddy vs. Ash by A.S. Eggleston. Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood slasher librarian saying thanks for listening, be excellent to each other, and be sure to shop smart. Shop S-Mart. Hell's the king, baby.